Thank you so much for your time today. I really appreciate it. And I cannot stop thinking about this movie. Being a parent of two amazing sons who are older now and grown, and thank goodness everything, they're all good. But wow, this was a hard one. This was a hard one to watch, but it was so powerful and so riveting. I couldn't stop watching. So congratulations to your, bringing it to us because it's an important topic. And
Thanks.
I wanted to know, firstly, what made you think about writing this and getting this out there for, no pun intended, the masses to see it?
I hope it's the masses. I didn't know if I could forgive, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I didn't know. I'm gonna get emotional. Sometimes it just gets me. It still gets me a lot. It really started with that notion. And when I was in college, I learned about the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa. And it was sort of, it was taught, it was this amazing, inspiring thing, and this sort of beautiful, this work that they were trying to do, as opposed to find through punishment or retribution, just the sole effort was to heal this country.
Yeah.
And if you could forgive, and it was amazing, but I was so disturbed by it because I thought, I don't know if I could do that. I don't know if I want that. Like I would think about losing a loved one or a family member. I want punishment. I want retribution. And
Right.
it's because it also sort of that meant that kind of I knew that means, well, that's hate, that's resentment, that's pain. Like that's living with real hate and pain.
Yeah.
And so as a when I was a parent, in the wake of these shootings, first I thought I need to learn more about this because it was affecting me differently as a parent. And so I just started buying books and reading, going online, just because I felt like I needed to know. I was so disturbed, particularly by the Parkland shooting. And I came across these meetings. There's just a few you'll kind of find. You can just sort of look online and kind of read about some of these things. And it's this, you know, it's parents of victims meeting parents of perpetrators. And I thought, my God, it's the amnesty hearings, it's truth and reconciliation. They're just trying to heal. But it also made me confront, I had to confront that ability or fear or inability of my own to forgive, you know. And I thought, how do you move forward? Can I do this? Am I capable of it? How does this work? You know, so I started writing, you know. I thought I need to sort of, there was a part of me that was just this sort of personal exploration into these thoughts and ideas. And it was honestly, I've always dreamed of making movies, but it hadn't occurred to me necessarily as sort of, you know, I wanted this consciously to be sort of my first film and my first sort of statement. I mean, this was so emotional just for me personally, you know.
Listen, but it brings up so many interesting topics because you have these four, adults, the two sets of parents sitting around this table, getting it all out. And it makes you think, look, are the parents responsible for bringing up their child in this way? You cannot ever get an answer to that. You don't know why somebody does what they do. Yes, there's depression and there are signs, but you don't know, especially these days, with kids in their basements and sitting at their computers, and you cannot monitor them 24/7. So it's interesting to me that these parents need to get this out 100%, but are they ever gonna get an answer? No, right?
And that, I mean, look, of course I didn't read everything. There's just so many examples, and I could never do a completely comprehensive, you know, job at researching this, right?
100%. Yeah, I get it. Yeah.
My best, I did, I read, you know, it was 2 years, I read nothing but this stuff. And I never, look, I did not find monsters in parent, you know, I didn't find bad parents,
Right.
truly. And this will break, I mean, it still breaks my heart to even think about, but I like as a parent, even when my daughter was, you know, 1.5 around the time of Parkland, and when I started reading about these things, she's like a toddler, I still already realize I'm going to screw this up. Like every day I make mistakes.
Of course, no one's perfect, my friend. No one's perfect.
You love this thing, this person. more than anything, and yet you're losing all the time, and yet you're somehow this love and this in the unconditional quality of it, but it's this, there's somehow you still make mistakes, and it's, you're, how am I screwing this up, how am I so regretful of my decision when all I want is the best for her, you know? And so I knew that at that point, and I thought, my God, you know, what I saw when I was reading about it were those kind of relationships, right? You know what I mean, truly, I'm sure there's exceptions out there, but I never thought for a minute that I had good or bad people or protagonists. Antagonist. I never thought there was someone that we could, you know, we're going to find the blame eventually. I wrote these people as four equal human beings that had dignity and love for their children and real heartbreak and needed to plead the case truthfully. Yeah. So I tried to approach it that way, you know?
Yeah. And then, you know, look, you hit the jackpot with these four actors. You know, honestly, first of all, I don't even know what to say. Anne Dowd, I've loved her for a million zillion years. Reed Birney, give me a break. Like, honestly, Broadway veteran. And then Jason Isaacs, never seen him do something like this. And then Martha Plimpton, who can do comedy, drama. We've seen her in everything. You sit these four masterclass actors around a table. What, like, how do you even direct these people?
You know, it's funny. I mean, I recognized how lucky I was, right? I mean, I think that was the first step of saying, okay, yes, you're absolutely right. I'd hit the jackpot here. I never dreamed of a cast like that, truly. I just, you know, we didn't have any money. People were barely reading my screenplay at all, let alone, you know. So once these people got on board, I kind of knew, look, I need to give them a very long leash. The material is so sensitive. We don't have a lot of time.
Yeah.
It's probably important I'm not in the room. You know, we had my video village outside of the room. I wanted to keep the set so spare.
Yeah.
To just let these actors perform. It was almost stage-like in that sense that only the essential people were in there. You know, my cinematographer, my a boom operator. You know what I mean? It was almost
closed set. Yeah, it has to be.
Yeah, and we did a 2.5-day rehearsal in New York 3 weeks before we went to Idaho. And that was where I thought, look, you know, actors have great instincts, right? These actors are as good as it gets. They're better than I am. I need to ask them questions about where things aren't working. And I need to change it for them. Like if they feel like an emotional beat is not there or they're false at any single moment, I have to trust them and I should just rewrite it. And so we had this 2.5-day rehearsal that was kind of table work of sort of just slowly moving through it. And if there was ever something that sort of bumped for them, or if they felt like I'm not really clear on what I know or don't know here, and why am I asking this? And, you know, I don't want to listen to this person talk. And then you would write that. You would say, I don't want to listen to this. You know, I tried to bring those feelings and their instincts to the surface in the dialogue so that they would be carried with the dialogue to these emotional places. I felt like that was sort of the best job I could do as a director, was make sure the writing was there. Because once on set, you know, I wanted them to just be able to go, you know.
But to me, this was like watching a play. Like, I could have sat in a Broadway theater and I could have watched those four, you know, for 2 hours, no problem. Was there ever a thought in your mind that maybe I'll write this as a play? But then I'm glad you did it as a film, because, you know, I think more people will benefit from it, to be honest.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it. No, it my first drafts were screenplays. My heart was set on a movie. I've always wanted to make movies, but I realized, you know, man, this might be a play. This is, and I love theater. You know, I knew Reed through doing theater in New York. So you know, that I would have so much, you know, sort of the joy, and this would be such a fulfilling experience to sort of figure this out and put it on stage. And so it was for months a stage play, which I think just helped the writing in the sense that it had to feel like real life. You know what I mean? What you would be presenting up there, it had to be compelling and real and natural, and the dialogue had to be messy. And so I think the dialogue and the spirit of the screenplay just was so enriched by it, that process of when it was a stage play. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, not just was my heart set on it, but I really felt we'll never capture all the layers here on stage. I was worried that I just felt you had to have a camera lens. You know, you had to be able to see the private moments, internal moments, you know, the things that, you know, the asides between, you know, Martha Plimpton and Jason Isaacs or Reed Verney and Ann Dowd. And there was so much to capture that yeah. It just, you know, got it. This has to be on film. And my heart was sort of set on that from the beginning.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I mean, yeah, no, it totally works. I have a couple minutes, so I have two things I want to ask you. Did you meet with brief counselors or have them meet with brief counselors? So was that important?
I spoke with some people. I spoke with some people and I spoke with some, mothers that had worked with Moms Demand Action and Everytown. I spoke with some journalists. The actors, there was interest in it. And then eventually they felt like, no, we need to just sort of do this ourselves.
Sure. Yeah.
The time of it, the intensity of it, the actors just needed to let their guard down. We just had to become close. Like the five of us now are sort of this unit and family.
I'm sure.
And emailing, it was such an emotional experience that I felt like, and I respected it. I understood that by the time we got to Idaho, there was the talk about meeting with some mothers, and they, you know, they ultimately said, you know, we just need to sit in this, the four of us, and figure out what we're doing, you know. And I mean, look, I think they're four of the best performances you'll see this year, but also I think people will talk about them collectively for a very long time.
100%.
But I tried to do as much as I possibly could. I have a lot of sort of concern, and I'll just say it, some insecurity about the fact that I've never experienced this myself, anything like it, or I have no direct experience or even know anyone. And so I my thoughts, like at the front of my mind, are those communities, survivors, families, the people who have really experienced these things and how they might receive this movie. Hmm. I had the honor of meeting a parent yesterday who had lost a child in a shooting. And
wow, Fran, wow.
I'm sorry. You know, it's obviously very emotional, but it was you know, I told her that, you know, this has been the most rewarding journey of my life, but that meeting her was the most exceptional moment of it, because
that's what it's about. That's what you want. You want it to touch and hopefully help. Honestly, yeah. I you know, I could talk to you for another hour and a half about this, but I'm sure there's other people waiting to talk to you. And you know, look, we're used to seeing you on screen, in front of screen, and so bold and brave of you to do this. I hope that your ability as an actor was able to help you with your direction, because I thought you did a tremendous job, honestly.
Yeah, it's funny, you know, I as an actor, when I would walk into the room, take that long walk into the room, I was so self-conscious of, you know, saying the wrong thing, or like, would you want to hear this? Like, I don't know if you'd want to hear that. So maybe I'm crazy. I don't know. I think being an actor like got me in my head quite a bit. It's certainly now I did an acting job for HBO Max. I'm doing a TV show about Julia Child. It's going to be great and really sweet.
Yeah, but I can't wait to see that. I heard about that. Yeah.
Funny, I got to those sets and I just thought, just shut up and do your job. Just don't slow down production. You know, I had a whole different way of about things as now that I've directed something. Yeah.
Well, good on you. Thank you for doing this. Like I said, it is the most powerful film I've seen in years. It's brilliant. And you know, fingers crossed I get to talk to Anne and Reed next week, because I don't even know what I'm so excited to talk to them both.
Going out there to shoot a TV show, so I hope you guys get to talk to him too. Yeah,
I hope so. I would talk to everybody in this film. It's brilliant. Thank you so much for your time today. I really appreciate it, and best of luck with everything, and come visit us in Toronto when you can. Okay.
Oh, I can't wait. Yeah.
All right, take care. Thank you for your time today. Appreciate it.
Yeah, bye-bye.
Okay, bye.